Good afternoon. So welcome to all of you. Thank you for coming. We have one of the special events of the year today. We have this the ceremony for the Ramanujan Prize. As you know, it's the prize in honor of Ramanujan, who is one of the top mathematicians in history, very young. So it's given to a young mathematician from developing countries. And we are happy to have today here the first secretary of the Indian Embassy to give the award the prize. And I have to also mention that today with us we have the new students who are just arriving for the new for the year for the diploma course. So we also want to welcome them. I hope that this will be the first nice experience at ICTP. And by saying that, I will let the word to Fernando Villegas, who is the head of the mathematics section, to introduce the prize and the awardee.
Thank you, Fernando. So as Fernando said, the Ramanujan Prize is awarded yearly to a mathematician from developing countries under the age of 45. It's funded by the Department of Science and Technology of India, and is awarded jointly by DST, the Department of Science and Technology, the International Mathematical Union, and the ICTP. This is probably a well-known story to all of you, but it's worth repeating, I think. Srinivasa Ramanujan, who is the mathematician in whose name the prize is given, in the early 1900s, while he was working at the Port Trust office in what was then called Madras in India, in an accounting job, wrote letters to English mathematicians with his discoveries. And only G.H. Hardy, which at the time was one of the most well-known mathematicians in England, paid any attention to these letters. Initially, he thought that they were possibly a fraud, and he eventually came to recognize the Ramanujan's originality and wrote in amazement, the theorems defeated me completely. I had never seen anything like this before. These theorems must be true, because if they were not true, no one would have the imagination to invent them. Our 2015 winner of the Ramanujan Prize is Amalindu Krishna. Amalindu was born in India, did his PhD at the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in Mumbai, India, where he is now in the faculty. After his PhD, he went to the United States and was a Hendrick Assistant Professor at UCLA from 2001-2004. He was a member of the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton 2004-2005, and went back to India to the Tata Institute. He has received a B.M. Birla Science Prize in Mathematics in 2009, the Swarna Yanti Prize in Math from the Government of India in 2011. The prize is given in recognition of Krishna's outstanding contributions in the area of algebraic K-theory, algebraic cycles, and the theory of motives. In his work, Krishna has shown an impressive command of a very technical subject, applying the modern theories of algebraic K-theory and Wojtkowski's theory of motives to study concrete problems. As one of the UCLA students said in a review of his teaching, Professor Krishna is one hell of a math professor. I think this is something we all in this profession should aspire to. And so, without any further ado, I welcome the First Secretary, Verma, to give the prize to our winner this year. And now Amalindu will give the Ramanujan lecture, whose title is Algebraic Cycles and Cohomology Theories.
Okay, so good afternoon to all of you. Before I go into more serious thing of talking mathematics, I have to thank various people, so please bear with me for some time. I had heard of this Ramanujan Prize from ICTP before, but I could never think that I was kind of good enough to get any of these prizes. So I was kind of basically pretended to be oblivious of this prize and kept working. So until I got an email from Honorable Director of ICTV, Professor Quevedo Fernando, and I was kind of very surprised to see this email. So it took me some time to believe it. Then I asked one of the senior faculty member in Tata Institute, is that true? That, and he said, yeah, maybe possibly true. So I don't know. Then I got another email from Professor Villegas. So I thought, maybe this is indeed true. When I read the letter from Professor Quevedo Fernando, and then the later there was a mention of the list of members in the selection committee to choose this award. And when I saw the names of the mathematicians in that list, the kind of eminence those mathematicians achieved, and getting a recognition from those people was really humbling for me. So I would like to thank each and every member of the selection committee for this Ramanujan Prize, including Professor Fernando Villegas, for recognizing my mathematical piece of work. I would also like to thank ICTP, IMU, and DST for organizing this prize. I would like to thank each and every individual or organization who or which, directly or indirectly, played any role in giving this prize. I would like to thank every individual present here today to make this event memorable for me. And finally, I would like to thank my family, especially my wife and daughter, who just see her side every day makes my day. So thank you all of you once again. And now let me begin my lecture today. Okay, so so this lecture is about algebraic cycles and cohomology theories. So cohomology theories in mathematics is a very, very, very old thing. Everybody knows about cohomology theories, but algebraic cycles are not as old as cohomology theories. So what is the motivation and background of this problem? Well, so let K be a field and let X be a smooth variety. So for people who are not from algebraic geometry, variety means basically you have a some field and you have a like basically some collection of polynomials, and you look at the set of points where those polynomials simultaneously vanish. So a smoothness means basically just like not any kind of variety, but it's kind of like in topology what we call a manifold. So it's a kind of algebraic analog of manifold, smooth manifolds. So recall that associated to any such variety X, there are various known cohomology theories, namely algebraic K theory, which is one of the most complicated ones among all these, singular cohomology, which is the most well-known among all. And then something called allelic cohomology discovered by Grothendieck. And then there is PID cohomology, and of course, well-known Dirac cohomology. Also recall that except K-theory, each of these forms what is called a Weyl cohomology theory if X is projective. So Weyl cohomology theory is a cohomology theory which was invented by Grothendieck because he wanted to prove what is called now the Weyl conjectures. So recall that what is an algebraic cycle? Algebraic cycle on a variety is a linear combination. Here, linear combination means the integral linear combinations of closed subvarieties. One applies various equivalence relations on these linear combinations to define cohomology theories using algebraic cycles. So a homological way of saying that a variety is determined by all of its points of various dimensions is that a variety is basically determined by its algebraic cycles. If you know all the algebraic cycles, essentially you know the variety itself in a kind of loose way. Now the question we are interested in can be roughly phrased as follows. Given a cohomology theory H star of X as above, is it possible to describe it purely in terms of algebraic cycles? So because you know you want the cohomology theory to give you information about the variety. So if I can detect this cohomology theory by the algebraic cycles, that will help me to understand the variety itself using these cohomology theories. Because then it will say that these cohomology theories themselves are some kind of cycles. So this question may look a little vague at the moment, but let's try to make some sense. Well, there could be two possible meanings to asking if this H star X can be described by algebraic cycles. So the first meaning of the problem could be the following. Let us assume that X is a smooth projective variety. Then we know that every Weyl cohomology theory and also algebraic theory received cycle class maps from the Chow groups. These Chow groups are basically algebraic cycles on X, modulo some kind of equivalence relation, where the equivalence relation is generated by family of cycles, which are parameterized by rational points on the projective lines. Now there is a cycle class map from the Chow group of co-dimension I cycles to H2I of X, where this is any of those cohomology theory. Now the question is, how much of H star of X can be described by cycles via this map? Well, it is immediately clear that this is a weak question because the way it was the cycle class map was defined, the odd degree cohomology classes can never be detected by algebraic cycles. Even in even degrees, only a small part can possibly be covered by the algebraic cycles. And the well-known Hawes and Tate conjectures give precise formulation of this measurement, namely how much of these cohomologies, even degree cohomology classes, be algebraic. Furthermore, Hawes and Tate conjectures are so hard that we do not know if it is a good idea to pursue this approach of understanding the cohomology via algebraic cycle. So let's turn to another way of describing this cohomology by cycles. So now the question is, can we completely describe the sieves defining this cohomology by algebraic cycles? Notice that all the cohomology theory which we described, they can be described as sieve cohomology on the varieties. So basically, you can define a sieve, and then you can take its cohomology, and that will give you which cohomology you take. Depending on that, you have to choose appropriate topology on the variety. Okay, so now the more precisely the question is there a Jarisky sieve? So now I take the Jarisky, the usual topology, algebraic topology on schemes. Jarisky sieve of chain complexes of algebraic cycles, which I call here TCHX, on X, such that if I take these sieves of cycles and take its cohomology, then I completely get my given cohomology. So that's the question. That I have a cohomology theory of a variety, and I want to understand this in terms of cycles in this sense. Namely, I can take some collection of cycles, make a sieve out of it, and then I take the cohomology, and that will give me the cohomology theory itself. So it looks kind of a very surprising thing, but let's see how it works. So the aim of this talk is to address this question for the DRAM and the crystalline cohomology. We shall concentrate on the crystalline cohomology because its original construction is very complicated. So before we state our results, let's give a brief introduction to the original and other known constructions of crystalline cohomology. So crystalline cohomology was a whale cohomology, which was invented by Grothendieck and described in a complete way by Berthelot. And this was the idea behind the genesis of crystalline cohomology was you needed some kind of cohomology theory where you can prove some kind of whale conjectures. And Grothendieck et al. Cohomology had this problem that it worked only when you take L, which is prime to the characteristic. So the et al. Cohomology could not detect the p-adic phenomenon. So you needed some kind of p-adic cohomology, and which is now called the crystalline cohomology. So let K be a perfect field of characteristic p positive, and let WK denote the ring of p typical bit vectors. So for any integer n, you have let WNK denote the ring of p typical bit vectors of length n. Recall that, so what is this ring of bit vectors? Well, before, without getting into the technical definition, basically it is a mixed characteristic discrete valuation ring with the field of fraction K and a residue field K. So if you have a perfect field K of positive characteristic, you can always construct a discrete valuation ring whose residue field is exactly your given field K, and its fraction field contains the field of rational numbers. So this helps in many of the lifting problems. For example, if I take K to be the finite field FP, then this ring of bit vectors is exactly the ring of p-adic integers. Recall that this ring WK is equipped with two distinguished operators called Frobenius F and Wurzeling B, which satisfy certain properties. So F is a ring endomorphism, while V is just an additive group homomorphism for WK. It is also known that WNK, and you have this, because it's a discrete valuation ring, so when you take WNK, you have this principal ideal, canonical principal ideal that I call P. So it has a canonically defined, what is called the divided power structure gamma, so that this becomes a divided power ring. So I will not go into the divided power, what divided power ring is. Basically, the idea is that in any ring, you want to sort of exponentiate certain kind of elements. In characteristic zero, you can exponentiate a function, but characteristic P, you cannot because you cannot divide by P. So you kind of artificially put some structure where you can do this thing. And this kind of artificial structure is called the divided power ring, which allows you to exponentiate certain elements in the ring. So actually, this construction of ring of bit vectors can be done for any K algebra R. It need not be just the field K itself. So the same story goes. In particular, if you have X, a smooth scheme of finite type over this field K, which is a perfect field of characteristic P, you can use the functoriality of this assignment R going to ring of bit vector WR. You can make WOX as a sieve of rings, and similarly WNOX. So in fact, one can prove that this locally ringed space X, WNOX is a scheme of finite type over WNK. Furthermore, it is projective over WNK if X was projective over the field K. Now, setting Sn equal to a spectrum of WNK and Xn equal to the spectrum of WNOX, remember this WNOX is a sieve of rings now. So this Xn need not be a fine scheme, it depends on what your X was. So we see that Xn mapping to Sn is a morphism of finite type, which a scheme theoretic closed fiber is your original X. Well, okay. Now what you construct something called the crystalline site of X. So the crystalline site, Chris N of X, is a category with a Grothendieck topology, whose objects, so the Grothendieck topology was again invented by Grothendieck in order to define his et al. Cohomology, et al. Topology. Because Italian topology is not given by open subsets of schemes. You need some kind of outer kind of topology on your scheme, and that is now well known as Grothendieck topology. So Grothendieck topology, which objects are triple T, U, delta, where U is a Jarecki open subset of your given scheme X, and T is a scheme of finite type over W and K, such that U sitting inside T is a closed immersion. And remember that since our characteristic is P, it is essentially force that the ideal of this closed immersion U inside T is nilpotent. So in particular, the topological space of U and the topological space of T are homeomorphic. So, and then you have this idea of morphisms of, so a morphism of these two triples is a morphism of PDA schemes over W and K, so that when I restrict this map to W, U prime, this is a usual open, old open immersion of U prime into U. The crystalline topology is generated by the family of morphism like that, so that if you restrict to T alpha mapping to T, this is a usual Jarecki open cover of your T. The category of sheaves of sets on this Grothendieck site with its canonical topology is called the crystalline topos of X. This is all in the language of Grothendieck. Now there is a morphism. Remember on your original X, there is a Jarecki site where the open subsets are usual open subsets. And you have these crystalline sites. And you have a natural map. And so such that if you take the Jarecki sheaf on X, then you can take its upper star, and you can also take its lower star. So such a more basically, you can think of as a map of topological spaces in a very like broad categorical way. So basically, it tells you that this UX is a continuous map of topological categories. Okay, in other words, so let's define, now what's the crystalline cohomology of X? So the crystalline cohomology of X is the cohomology in the crystalline site of the sheaf OX, which is the structured sheaf, which is given by, for any triple T U delta, you evaluate, it just take the ring of functions on the space T. That I call the structured sheaf of X in the crystalline topology. So you take this sheaf and take its sheaf cohomology in the crystalline side. That is called the crystalline cohomology of X. And remember that this n was any positive integers, and wn plus 1 maps to wn. So I can take the inverse limit of this cohomology, and that I write as X over W, which means that this is the crystalline cohomology of X, where X was any smooth projective variety over a perfect field of characteristic P. So that's the definition of crystalline cohomology. Well, now you see the way the crystalline cohomology is defined is fairly complicated. How do I sort of compute it? It's like you define some Grothendieck site, and then you have some sheaf, and how do I compute its cohomology? So a priori, it looks very complicated. So Bloch gave a different description of this crystalline cohomology. So Bloch's idea was the following. He says that, well, you replace this crystalline site by the usual Jarecki site of X. You don't discover any new site. Only thing you have to do is that you replace this crystalline sheaf by some kind of Jarecki sheaf, which are given by the sheaves of algebraic K theory of infinitesimal thickening of Jarecki open subset of X. So basically, he replaced this OXX by some kind of Jarecki sheaf of K theory. Well, the K theory themselves are very complicated, but nonetheless, to Bloch, K theory were much more well known than this crystalline site. So it was more familiar to people. So more precisely, Bloch constructed a chain complex of Jarecki sheaves like this, where the sheaves are basically given by, you see that it's basically some kind of Milner K theory. You take your ring and take the truncated polynomial ring, and it has a Milner K theory, and you map it to the K theory of your ring, and the kernel is basically, that is the sheaf which Bloch takes in this complex. And then here is the theorem of Bloch. He says that let's assume that your P is at least 3, and also the dimension of X is strictly less than P. This is a very, very strong condition which Bloch had to put. Then he says that if X is a smooth and projective over your K, then crystalline cohomology is nothing but the Jarecki cohomology of his complex of K theory sieves. So this was his theorem. It was a remarkable theorem at that time because it says that crystalline cohomology is basically is Jarecki cohomology of some much simpler kind of sieves. Well, it's not easy to compute these sieves, but nevertheless, it's kind of there are tools available to handle them. Now, after Bloch, there was another approach of Illouci to define, to understand this crystalline cohomology. So before Grothendieck, Sayre had suggested that some higher version of this cohomology of sieve of ring of bit vectors should give rise to a PID cohomology theory. Sayre did not know this, what is called higher, or the higher version of this ring of bit vectors, higher in the sense of you take the ring R itself, and then on the other hand, you have this ring of Keeler differentials. So higher in that sense, that you replace your ring by some kind of differential forms. So, but Sayre did not know what exactly this higher thing is. So Deligne outlined this higher version of W and OX in the form of what is now known as the p-typical Dirac bit complex. Deligne outline of this W and omega X was completed by Illouci in this famous paper. And here is a theorem of Illouci. Let X be a smooth scheme over K. Then there is a canonical map from this sieve, your crystalline sieve, to the Dirac bit complex. And it is basically isomorphism in the derived category. So it gives you isomorphism of the cohomology theory. So in particular, the old crystalline cohomology is again Jarecki cohomology of some sieves of differential forms. So they are not exactly sieves of differential forms, but some kind of like infinitesimal thickenings of these differential forms, so to speak, which I call the Dirac bit complex. So you take the Dirac forms, and then you put in the bit vectors in that, then I say it's the Dirac bit forms. So notice that unlike Bloch, Illouci had no condition on dimension X. So there was this improvement over the Bloch's theorem. No condition. P could be 2 or X could have any dimension. So in conclusion, we have the following diagram. We have this original crystalline cohomology. On the bottom, we have this Illouci's Dirac bit cohomology. And on your top right, you have this Bloch cohomology of sieves of p-typical curves on K3. That's what he said. So you have this diagram. Now there is a question mark here. So the question is that can you construct something over here such that this whole diagram commutes? So that Bloch's construction and Illouci's construction can be basically unified. So our result can now be stated as follows. This is the result theorem with my collaborator, Jinian Park. So I still have to assume that the characteristic is not equal to 2 for some reason at the moment. But no assumption on the dimension of X. So let X be a smooth scheme over K. Then there is a pre-sieve of chain complexes of algebraic cycles. If you take their sieveifications, then there is a map from the Illouci's Dirac bit complex to this cycle complex. And there is a map from the cycle complex to Bloch complex, such that the first map is a derived isomorphism. And the second map is an isomorphism if X is projective and dimension of X is strictly less than P, which was the condition in Bloch. So in particular, it tells you that there is a complex constructed purely out of algebraic cycles, which recovers Illouci's theorems and also recovers Bloch's theorem. So basically, yeah. So basically, you can unify this Bloch's construction and Illouci's constructions and original construction of crystalline cohomology by algebraic cycles. So what are these algebraic cycles? We now describe our cycles which give rise to this complex. In order to construct this, we do not need any perfectness assumption now on K, except that we only assume that so K has characteristic different from 2. So now we have any field K of characteristic not equal to 2 to define the cycle complexes. Only to prove the theorem, you need the assumption that characteristic is positive. So for a smooth affine scheme X, the complex is made up from what is called the additive higher Chow groups of X. So this is now a new theory which basically gives rise to this connection between crystalline cohomology and Dirac cohomology and Bloch's cohomology. So what is the motivation behind these additive higher Chow groups? Well, the motivation behind the discovery of additive higher Chow groups was the belief that the relative algebraic K-theory of nilpotent ideals in a ring and the modules of differential forms on a smooth scheme should be motivic in whatever sense. So remember that when Spencer Bloch constructed his theory of higher Chow groups, there was a problem with that higher Chow groups in the sense that it worked well only for a smooth varieties. If you have a smooth variety, then Bloch proved that his higher Chow groups rationally is same as higher K theory. However, this Bloch's theorem miserably fails if the variety is not smooth. Then we have no theory of higher Chow groups of motivic cohomology which can describe your algebraic K theory. And this idea behind the discovery of additive higher Chow groups was something like this: to construct a motivic cohomology theory which could describe K theory of any scheme whatsoever. So for a field K, the additive higher Chow groups of zero cycles, which I write at TCHN, this one is basically something like this WN in Dirac-Bir complex. So now there you can think of N equal to 1. So it was invented by Bloch and Eno in this paper. And what they showed is the following. They showed that if I take a field K and take the Chow group, additive Chow group of zero cycles, then it is essentially isomorphic to the module of absolute Keeler differentials on that field. So this is a first indication that this has something to do with the Dirac-Bir complex. Then Ruling generalized Bloch's Eno theorem, where he replaced this one by any m. And this m is basically this the length of the bit vectors in the Dirac-Bir complex. So this m is corresponding to that. So he showed that there is a natural isomorphism from this the field the Chow group of zero cycles to the Dirac-Bir complex, which was defined by Hessel, Herold, and Madsen. You should notice that this Dirac-Bir complex is not quite same as, basically this one is not quite same as the p-typical one, where I just wrote W. So this is slightly, is a more general form of Dirac-Bir complex, which was defined by Hessel, Herold, and Madsen. And the p-typical one is basically a direct summand of this. So now here is the construction of additive cycle complex for any. So remember that the Bloch Eno or ruling only defined zero additive zero cycles on that also only for field. So at that time there was no definition of additive higher Chow groups for any scheme or not only zero cycle but any cycle of any dimension. So this was done by Park and independently by Krishna and Levine in 2008. And it was shown by Krishna and Levine that there is a functor from X going to this additive higher Chow groups, which is a kind of non-homotopy invariant Borel-Moore homology theory on the category of quasi-projective schemes over K. So it's a theory which is not homotopy invariant in the sense that if you take a vector bundle over the scheme, then this theory becomes different, unlike the usual cohomology theory like singular cohomology and so on. And that's kind of expected because algebraic K theory of singular schemes is not homotopy invariant. They also showed that additive higher Chow groups have a canonical structure or module over the motivic cohomology ring or the Bloch's higher Chow groups. So these additive higher Chow groups are modules over the Bloch's higher Chow groups, which are already known before. So here is the definition, which is kind of technical, so let me just skip this. So the basic idea of this additive higher Chow groups is that you define exactly like the cycle complex of block, but what you do is that you put some kind of modulus conditions for every cycle. And this modulus is basically, this describes this length of the bit vectors which you are going to connect these two. So there is some modulus condition. So this modulus condition is basically, you know, like when you define your simplex, then you take the Euclidean space and take set of all vectors with sum is equal to 1. So I can, by sort of like suitable normalization, I can take this term, sum, all such points where sum is equal to any non-zero integers. And then when I take the limit when the non-zero integer becomes sort of like infinity, and I write like 1 over lambda, then it becomes sort of 0. So basically, see, this shows some kind of like what happens to these cycles at infinity. So this is some kind of condition, and that is what gives rise to some algebraic additive higher Chow groups. So here is some definitions. So, you know, basically there are some cycles with some modulus conditions. Now let me give you an example of how this additive higher Chow group works. So let R be an essentially a finite type of smooth K algebra. Then I can define a map from the ring R to CH. 1, R, 1, comma 1. So here, that CH upper 1 means the co-dimension 1 cycle in a spectrum of R cross A1. That's what in meaning. The meaning of that is this. So you take aspect R cross A1 and take co-dimension 1 cycle over there. And with the modulus is 1. Then I want to define a map. And the map is very easy. You take any element A in R and take the cycle, which is the zero locus of the function, 1 minus A times T in A1 over R. And you can see that this is, in A1 R, modulus condition is equivalent to saying that your cycle does not touch T equal to 0. And that's clear because T equal to 0 and 1 minus A T equal to 0 have no common solutions. So it's a well-defined cycle. And then you can define, so this defines, and then you can prove that this defines actually a group homomorphism from R to this cycle group. And here is some sketch of the proof. So it defines a group homomorphism. And it turns out that this map is actually an isomorphism if R is a unique factorization domain. So this gives you another evidence that this cycle group, unlike block cycle group, they are more sort of additive than multiplicative. In the block language, if I remove this T, then I will get something called R star over there. But here, by putting that T here, I replace R star by R. So this becomes this one. So that's the basic difference between block higher Chow groups and additive higher Chow group. If you take the block higher Chow group, you will get R star, but here you get R. More generally, for any semi-local ring R, you can define a map from the module of Taylor differentials to co-dimension n cycle complex in a spectrum of R cross AN. And they are defined in this form. You can check that it's a well-defined cycle. And remember that if R is a semi-local ring containing an infinite field, then any element in ring R can be written as sum of two units. And that's why this differential form is generated by the logarithmic forms. So the proposition is you have a map from the Taylor differential to additive Chow groups, and in fact it turns out that this is also an isomorphism if R is a regular semi-local K algebra. So now what are the main results? The example given above is a prototype of the more general result, which was motivated by the following slogans. The slogan is, the differential forms, as well as the operations on them, namely differential, base product, etc., on a smooth schemes are all motivic. It's kind of surprising thing if you try to think about it. you know, algebraic cycles and K-theory, they have no like additive thing. There's no differential forms over there. And you are saying that even the modules, basically the quasi-coherent sieves, can be described in terms of cycles. That's what it's saying. Because these differential forms are kind of quasi-coherent sieves. So the credit for this slogan goes to Spencer Block, whose various work indicate that he must have already imagined this long time ago, and his work with Elaine Eno on additive dialogue, which gave birth to additive cycles, was a step towards achieving this vision. In order to state the local forms of main result, we need to recall the following concept of bit complexes over a ring, and this concept is due to Ilusi in the p-typical case and Hesselholm-Madsen in the general case. So here is a definition of restricted bit complex, which I will skip, some technical definition. And the p-typical Dirac bit complex of Deligne and Ilusi was generalized by Hesselholm and Madsen for any truncation set S. In particular, if I take S equal to 1 to up to M, we get what is called the big Dirac bit complex, Wm omega r. Now if you take S equal to 1, p up to p to the n minus 1, where p is a fixed prime, then you exactly get back Ilusi's p-typical Dirac bit complex. So one of the results of Hesselholm and Madsen is the following. They say that the big Dirac bit complex Wm omega r is a universal restricted bit complex over r. It's a universal object in the category of bit complexes. In other words, given any restricted bit complex E dot M over R, here dot means they are basically differential graded algebras. There is a unique morphism from that big Dirac bit complex to E dot M. Now we set W dot R to take the inverse limit over all M, and there's a simple W is the P-typical one, if R is a ZP algebra. Another useful fact about Dirac bit complex is the following. If R is a ZP algebra, then there is a P-typicalization functor. If you take the big Dirac bit complex, you can apply this functor to get the usual P-typical complex of Ilusi. And if R contains Q, then this Dirac bit complex is nothing but some direct sum of usual Dirac complex. So basically, this Dirac bit thing is a new thing in characteristic P only. In characteristic 0, it is nothing but the old Dirac complex. We can now state the main result, which generalizes the previous example. So you look at, you write this TCHRM as the sum of all additive chalk groups of R. And here is a theorem. Let K be a field of characteristic not equal to 2. Let R be an essentially a finite type regular semi-local K algebra, then the additive higher chalk groups of R form the universal restricted bit complex over R. So this is a universal restricted bit complex. In other words, by universality, it tells you that this must be isomorphic to the big Dirac bit complex. So it tells you that the Dirac bit complex of Ilusi's or the big Dirac bit complex of Hesselholm and Madsen are nothing but additive higher chalk groups. They can be described completely by algebraic cycles. So notice that the part of the assertion of this theorem is that this additive higher chalk groups are equipped with many structure. It must have a differential map because it's supposed to be a differential graded algebra, must have Weyl's product, must have Frobenius, must have the Birchbaum operators, and so on. And now how do I give all this structure is given by these maps. So since TCHR is a restricted bit complex, I can apply the P-typicalization functor to get P-typical additive higher chalk groups. So now, so we have seen that for a local ring or semi-local ring, a Dirac bit complex is same as additive higher chalk groups. Now I want to simplify this to make a sieve out of additive higher chalk groups. So how do I do that? So this is achieved by using the following theorem by Wataru Kai in 2015. He proved that additive higher chalk groups on the category of a smooth affine schemes over K is a pre-sieve, in the sense that it's a contravariant functor. If you take a map from a ring A to B, then additive higher chalk group of A maps to additive higher chalk groups of B. So So it's a precip on a smooth affine schemes. Now I can use some standard construction to make it a precip on all schemes by some sort of like limit, co-limit construction. So here is how you do it. So basically the idea is that if you have a nice kind of precip on the category of smooth affine schemes, then you can extend this precip in a canonical way to a precip on all schemes. That's what this method does. So, and you can do the same thing to define this Dirac-Bitt complex, sieves of Dirac-Bitt complex on all schemes. And it turns out that this is same as if you take Wi omega nx, this is same as the Illouz's Dirac-Bitt complex. Now, as a corollary of that previous theorem, it follows that if x is a smooth scheme, then there is an isomorphism of chain complex of Jarecki sieves, where this side is the Dirac-Bitt complex modded out by P to the I, and this side is also the sieves of additive higher Chow groups modded out by P to the I. So basically, the Dirac-Bitt sieves are same as the sieves of additive higher Chow groups. Now, it follows from a theorem of Illouz that if you take W omega, this one, and this maps to this Wi omega x, and Illouz says that this is not an isomorphism, but it's a quasi-isomorphism. Combining these results with above corollary and the main result of Illouz, we conclude the following. Let K be a perfect field of characteristic P, at least 3. Let X be a smooth scheme. Then there is a canonical isomorphism where this side is the old crystalline cohomology, and this side is the cohomology of sieves coming from additive higher Chow groups. This is just additive higher Chow groups made into the precepts on the Jarecki side of X. So here I related crystalline cohomology I related additive higher Chow groups with crystalline cohomology. So now how do I relate additive higher Chow groups with the Bloch's construction? To relate additive higher Chow groups with the Bloch's construction, you need to construct a cycle class map here from the additive higher Chow groups. Remember, this was the sieve taken by Bloch, the K-theory sieves. I have to connect them, I have to construct some kind of cycle class map from here to here. How do I do this? And this is it requires a very hard theorem. And here, this is a theorem which we will use. This is a theorem again with Park. And this says the following. Let R be as above. Then this additive higher Chow groups are generated by some very special kind of cycles. This I call a moving lemma for additive higher Chow groups for semi-local rings. So you can basically move your given cycle in such a way that they are a very nice form. Basically, they are of this form. So any cycle it can be generated like this. But once you have a cycle like that, it's very easy to define the cycle class map. You just take any cycle Z, which is of the form given by A, B1, B2, Bn minus 1. You simply take the Milner symbol here. So here, this curly bracket is missing here. This would be a curly bracket here. So this is a Milner symbol in R prime. And then because R prime to R is a finite map, I can take the norm map on Milner K theory, or which is called the push forward map on K theory. And I get back to the element in this group. So this is the way I define, and then you saw that this actually kills the equivalence relation over here, and so that it actually defines a map, and this you achieve by using some results of Illouz again. So this gives you a map again from additive higher Chow groups to the Bloch construction. So if you sieveify, you get the maps of sieves. And combining our main results with some results of Illouz obtained, let K be a perfect field with the same condition, then, and the extra condition which was put by Bloch, the dimension of X is bounded by P, then this additive higher Chow groups are the same as the Bloch's construction. So as a combination of all these things, what we have achieved is the following diagram. Remember, this was our Christine cohomology. This was the Bloch's cohomology. This was Illouz's cohomology. And here you have this higher chalk, additive higher chalk groups. And it tells you what we have proven, that this is an isomorphism. This was Illouz's isomorphism. This was Bloch's isomorphism when X has bounded dimension. And we proved that this is also an isomorphism when X has bounded dimension. So this is the main result which we stated in the beginning, and this is how you achieve it. So if the characteristic of K is zero, then basically all the result tells you that if X is a smooth affine scheme of finite type over a field of characteristic zero, then you look at the Dirac cohomology of X, it tells you that this Dirac cohomology here, the usual Dirac cohomology of X is same as the cohomology of cycle complex, cohomology of sieves of additive higher chalk groups that are given like this. It's a Stariski sieve which is stuck at any point in the additive chalk group of this local ring. In particular, the absolute Dirac cohomology can be described by algebraic cycles. So now some applications of this theorem, apart from connecting this, those pictures. So when S.L. Holt and Madsen defined this Dirac bit complex, there is a question by S.L. Holt that suppose R to R prime is a finite map of Noetherian regular K algebras. Can you define a nicely behaved trace maps on these Dirac bit complexes? A trace map for Keller differential was constructed by Kunz. As a consequence of existence of, remember that for additive higher chalk groups, it was a Borel-Moore theory, so it has a push-forward map for finite map. So I have a push-forward map on the additive higher chalk groups, and I have proven that these guys are same as additive higher chalk groups. Using that, now we can indeed construct this trace map. So this solves a problem raised by S.L. Holt. Another consequence of, this application was how to use additive higher chalk groups to conclude something about the known Dirac bit things. Now, if you turn the picture around, suppose you know something about the Dirac bit thing, can you prove something about additive higher chalk groups? And this is what it says. For Dirac bit complex, the Gersten conjecture was proven by M. Gross. And now using this isomorphism, we can prove the Gersten conjecture for additive higher chalk groups as well. Now some new questions. Well, the isomorphism between Dirac bit complex and additive higher chalk groups provides a new perspective of looking at the crystalline cohomology. One knows that the crystalline cohomology is not well behaved if the scheme is not proper and not smooth also. And a substitute was invented by Berthelot. This is called the rigid cohomology. If X is not smooth and proper, the crystalline cohomology can behave very badly. It could be like Hughes group, so which is not allowed for a well cohomology theory. So now the question is that, well, now you have this something coming from algebraic cycles. The question is, can one use these additive higher chalk groups to give a simplified or an entirely new construction of rigid cohomology? Again, the rigid cohomology is something, the construction is quite complicated. So the question was that does this theory of additive higher chalk groups allow you to say something about rigid cohomology? Now another question is the following. The additive higher chalk groups also make sense if you replace, there was some A1 factor in additive higher chalk groups, which I did not show you the full definition. Now you replace A1 by P1, again you can make sense of some additive higher chalk groups where I put this C for, this is compactified. And this says that the theorem again with Park is, let X be a smooth scheme over a field of characteristic not equal to 2, then there is a split sort exact sequence. So look at here, this is Bloch's higher chalk groups, this is additive higher chalk groups which I have been talking about, and this is something new which we can construct just by replacing this A1 by P1 in the definition of additive higher chalk group. So this theorem tells you that there is a theory of chalk groups which unifies blocks higher chaw groups and LED higher chaw groups. So now look at this diagram. So remember, you have this Milner K theory for ring here. You have the Dirac bit complex for the ring. Now, and remember this exact sequence here. This is also an isomorphism, which was proven by Eloy, Vincent, and Muller-Star, and this we have proven now. So the question is there some kind of algebraically defined object here which unifies the Milner-K theory and the Dirac bit forms? Remember that this Milner-K theory is a multiplicative theory, and this is an additive theory. So the question can be in a loose way. In other words, does there exist an algebraic object whose semi-simple part is the Milner-K theory and the unipotent part is the Dirac bit complex? So this lower diagram exact sequence tells you there should be something here which can be completely purely described in an algebraic way. So I stop it here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions for Amalindu? Anton?
Thank you. So you have a isomorphism between the big Dirac bit complex and the complex constructed from additive cycles, additive Chow groups. But in the characteristic zero, you stated results only relating cohomology series. Is there a more precise result relating the Dirac complex in characteristic zero and some kind of additive Chow cycles complex?
Yes, that works for characteristic zero as well. You have this theory of additive higher Chow groups, and that if you look, you make it a sheaf and make it take its cohomology, that is same as the Dirac cohomology in characteristic zero.
So is the story become more simple in that case and more?
It depends from what perspective you are looking at. So for people like us who want to understand things like cycle class maps and so on, and you want to understand the variety using Dirac cohomology, so to speak. But then it tells you that Dirac cohomology basically can be constructed from cycle on X itself. So sometimes it helps you understand the variety without going into Dirac cohomology. So that's the kind of perspective we choose. So because the cycles are more intrinsic to X than the Dirac cohomology.
Any further questions?
Thanks. Chow groups are defined and are very important also for singular varieties.
Yes.
Now, when you have singularities, things become much harder and many things don't work and so on. But is there any hope that some of these theories, which are so deep and so profound, can be adapted to varieties with, say, mild singularities?
I think it's a very good question, and answering your question is the part of the goal of this. So additive higher Chow groups is directly related with the supposedly Chow groups of singular varieties, which I just kept quiet about it. But the whole idea of additive higher Chow groups is to describe a cohomology theory or some kind of Chow groups for variety with any kind of singularities. And you cannot right now see how additive higher Chow groups describe the Chow groups of singularities, but there is a direct connection. So our hope is that this theory of additive higher Chow groups can be suitably adapted to define a cohomology theory for algebraic variety with singularity, a cohomology theory which can allow it to describe its K theory. So that's indeed true.
Any other question? Yes.
The field, you did not never assume field algebraically closed.
No.
It's not needed in the?
No, it's absolutely not needed. It could be any field as long as its characteristic is not equal to 2. We have some problems in characteristic two because to prove like this, the additive chow groups form a differential graded algebra and so on, sometimes you have to divide by two and that creates problem. Except for this mild problem, the theory goes through everywhere. So the problem is there that to prove that additive chow groups are differential graded algebra, I have to construct a differential. And to do that, and then I have to prove that the delta square is zero. And to do that, I have somehow divide by two. And that, so far, I don't know how to avoid this. So that's the only place where you use characteristic not equal to two, except that you do not have any assumption on the field.
Any?
So this works for real algebra, right, Marantis?
Yes. That's right, yes. No, you don't need perfectness also. So basically, there are a lot of tools where you can reduce the problem to perfect case. First you prove for perfect, and then you use a lot of tools, and then you sort of you build it up, and then you eventually remove this perfectness condition. So in the final assertion, you do not need perfectness.
I have a question. So you started by saying that crystalline cohomology was very difficult to compute in the original form. To what extent this new perspective changes that?
Well, so one of our motivation for proving this was that it was not clear that Dirac bit complex, things like that can be motivic because they are differential forms. And then we had some correspondences with Spencer Block, and then basically he was very excited about this, and we thought that first let's prove this to say that the crystalline cohomology can be obtained by algebraic cycles, and this is a very recent result, and we could prove some applications of this. Now, coming back to your question, that how much this is going to help understand the crystalline cohomology, I think our result is too new to say more about this. It will take some time for us to think about it more, and maybe eventually in a year or so, we may see some more about these things.
So a lot of work for everybody else as well.
Yes.
Any further comment or question?
In the topological K-theory, so you had the same kind of homomorphism you defined in the beginning of your slides, like Chern character from the topological K group to the Dirac cohomology group,
yes.
Right? So the you started by asking question means how can one describe this cohomology group in terms of algebraic cycles like this. Can we ask same type of question in topological K theory also?
Well, you know, like... In topology, so basically what I have been doing is what I did is I when you say that when I constructed the map from the additive higher chow groups to K theory, this map was the inverse to supposedly Chern character map from the algebraic K theory to some kind of cohomology theory. We proved that additive higher chow groups is a cohomology theory. And now what is left to be done is to construct some kind of Chern character from the relative K theory to these additive higher chow groups. We do not have the Chern character right now, but what we did right now is we defined the inverse to that. Because we often know that Chern character, particularly with tensor with Q, is an isomorphism. So if you are in characteristic zero, it is known that additive higher chow groups are automatically rational vector spaces. So you don't have a tensor with Q. So then you expect that the additive higher chow groups are isomorphic to relative K theory via the Chern character. So what I did here, one consequence was that I constructed the inverse of that Chern character map. Still, we do not have the formal Chern character from the relative K theory to additive higher chow groups. And remember that in topological setup, this does not make sense absolutely because there is no question, no concept of infinitesimal thickening of topological spaces. Because all topological spaces, you take a scheme X and take is reduced, topologically they are same. So topology, this question does not make sense at all. This is a kind of nilpotent phenomena which we are talking about, which is purely algebraic. In topology, this has no role to play because the spaces, whether X or X reduced, they are topologically same spaces.
Any other question? Let's thank Melinda one more time.